Michael Ben, you're on the line. A lot of people have grown up with your work. Now, what do you think is the biggest thing people know you for?
I would say in Canada, most people would know my voice from the first CGI animated series Reboot, where I played the character of Bob.
Now, your voice now sounds nothing like that of Bob. You're like 10 octaves too low.
Yeah, well, it's early for me. I'm an actor here. You're getting me up pretty early in my day here. I would say it's pretty much my voice, a little more, quote, animated. And it was also 20 years ago, you have to understand.
Oh, I guess.
So, I could still probably do it, but, compression and all that, you work in voiceover, all that.
Well, I heard something online. They're actually thinking about bringing the series back.
It's funny. I in the last year, I've done some conventions where one of the animators on the show invited me, and I got to meet the fans firsthand. And the first one I did was in Calgary about a year ago, and then I did one in Vancouver, and I just was in Edmonton 2 weekends ago.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the questions was, is the show coming back? And I said, I really don't know. And 2 days later, they announced that the show is coming back.
Wow.
So it was kind of funny timing on that.
Now, with the show coming back, are you going to be involved in that then at all, or are they going to recast some of the roles?
I really don't know what their plans are. They're going to reboot it. They're going to change it. I have no idea. But, I do different voices, so maybe I'll end up playing somebody else or something on the show. Who knows? So, but that's very exciting because, I didn't really realize how popular the show was because I was living in the States most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And when I came back, people tell you and you know these things intellectually,
mm-hmm.
but when you walk down the street, nobody knows that I am the voice of Bob from Reboot,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Like I give the example, I do a TV show on camera. Everybody knows Kiefer Sutherland is the star of 24, and they go, we love 24. Nobody knew until mm-hmm. I go to a convention and everyone says, by the way, this guy you're looking at now is Bob from Reboot. And then they tell you, I grew up with this show. This was my childhood. We watched it together as a family. And it became very touching when I realized just how many people it affected in Canada over the last 20 years, because it continues to play, and it's very nice.
It'd be pretty cool if they bring it back, because then it would be a reboot of Reboot, which is just awesome in itself. But you've done a ton of other voice acting over the years. Any other favorites that you could think of?
Wow. Well, when I first started, my first voice job, I was still in high school, was they did Barbie and the Rockers, Barbie and Ken, and I was the voice of Ken.
Ooh, hey.
And it was a big deal in Canada. I got in McLean's, and I was on Midday and all these things because the big joke was that the All-American was voiced by an All-Canadian. And
yeah.
There was a whole thing about me having maybe a Canadian accent at the time. They kept saying, you're saying a boot. And I said, I don't know what I don't have a boot. They're like, no, you're pronouncing the word about a boot. And I said, I don't think so. But maybe I became very sensitive to that at that point, and I really worked on my American accent. After that, I continued to do a lot of voiceover. I was on G.I. Joe. I did Sonic the Hedgehog. I did Reboot. I did a show called The Hurricanes, where I did a couple characters, Exo Squad. Most of these shows are forgotten over time, but Reboot seems to continue, and it's, people knowing it. And the show that brought me to the States at that time was I did a remake of the show Johnny Quest. I don't know if you remember that show.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah, I remember that.
And I did the voice of Haji on that show, and Haji was his Indian friend. So I was doing an Indian accent on that, and
wow.
That brought me to the States. And then, I was here in L.A. and back and forth, and I'm trying to think of some of the things that people would know over the years, like I did The Shield, I did 24, I did The Mentalist on camera, different
wow.
shows like that. And recently, I guess it's been, I don't know, since January or February, I've been doing a recurring role on camera on Days of Our Lives.
Hey.
Yes, and we shoot 4 months in advance, so I can't really reveal what's going on, but I'm on Days of Our Lives as Dr. Chaika. I am this kind of nefarious underworld doctor.
Oof.
So it's been a lot of fun.
And you've also played yourself. You had a couple small roles in a couple big movies as well, too.
Yes. I was in the G.I. Joe movie because when I auditioned, I had mentioned to them that I had been a voice on the original cartoon, and I think they were very excited about that. As it so happens, in the end, my face was cut out of the movie, but my voice remained. So in G.I. Joe the movie, I'm basically the voice of the ship near the end where it's about to detonate or something. And I ended up getting cast in Transformers 2 on camera, which Michael Bay directed. And I don't know if you remember the film, they go to Egypt at one point. and I end up being one of the two Egyptian Interpol agents who was after Shia LaBeouf's character in the movie.
So growing up and getting into it yourself, and what was kind of a big inspiration for you to get involved in all this stuff and the acting and the voice work and all that? What did it for you?
Well, you know, I was a kid. I was watching cartoons, you know, doing those things. But you're reminding me of a story. When I was a kid, my favorite show was Happy Days.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, you know, Fonzie was my favorite character. And I read an autobiography of him when I was about 9 years old. My mother gave me the book. And I kind of realized reading it that it was possible. He had gone to like a private day school like myself. And I just kind of had this dream as a kid. I think many kids want to be actors or athletes or musicians or whatever. And I was fortunate enough that I was in Vancouver at the time when a lot of productions started filming there in the late 80s. And I got an agent and I started doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I got lucky with the cartoon stuff, as I told you, with the Ken and the reboot and all that. Mm-hmm. But I'd always wanted to go to the States to try my hand in Hollywood. And as it so happened, the Johnny Quest show came about, and it got me my visa and then my green card eventually. Mm-hmm. And it allowed me to do it. But it was just something I always wanted to do, to answer your question. And I somehow have done it. And years later, I ended up doing a sitcom pilot with the Fonz, with Henry Winkler. So my childhood dream came true.
Wow, that is incredible, hey?
Yes.
Wow, the Fonz. He was actually just in Saskatoon for like one random event. He was at some lunch thing downtown one day. I didn't even know he was here. One of those things.
Around that the Fonz. He gets around.
You see him, and then you're like, that's not the Fonz. Why? What's he doing in Saskatoon? Turns out it's the Fonz. So you must have met some pretty cool people in your travels and in your times.
Oh, sure. I just told this story the other day. My first day when I did the Johnny Quest show, the casting woman said to her assistant, make sure Mark Hamill has all the sides.
Wow.
And I said, I'm sorry, Mark Hamill? And the sides of the recording pages. And she says, yes. And I says, as in Luke Skywalker. And she said, yes. I said, oh, my Lord. And she's like, what? I said, you don't understand. At the time I was 24, I said, from the age of 7 until 13, every day of my life was obsessed with Star Wars. I had the bedspread, the drapes, everything. And
wow.
She's like, well, that's nothing. She goes, do you know who Robert Patrick is? And I said, yes. She goes, he's going to be working with you every week. And Robert Patrick was the Terminator 1000. I said, well, that's not a big deal. He was famous after I was a kid. It's not as impressive to me. But yeah. I ended up working with Mark Hamill, and he was there one day, the first day. And as I went home, I kind of felt like Chris Farley. You remember the old, you know, where he'd be like, stupid, stupid, stupid. I should have asked what I always wanted to ask. And I asked him, I said to myself, if he ever shows up again, you will ask him. And he was there the next day.
Oh, wow.
So he came back, and I said in my 2 minutes, in my 2 minutes that I had between the rehearsal and the recording, I said, Mark, I heard this rumor when I was a kid that when you signed to do Star Wars, that you stipulated in your contract that you'd get one piece of merchandise, made in accordance with the film. Kind of, I said it jokingly, like, oh, that's ridiculous. He says, yes. Oh, I said, really? And he goes, yes. He goes, well, when we signed to do the movie, we thought there'd be a soundtrack and a book. We never thought there'd be toothpaste and, you know, pillow covers and all this. And I was like, oh, wow, wow. And I said, and I heard that you got so much stuff that you put it in an airplane hangar? And he says, yes. He goes, it wasn't an airplane hangar. It was a storage space. But, yes, I had so much stuff that I had to store it outside my home. And I said, what did you do with all the stuff? He says, well, I have kids, too, and I gave my kids the action figures, and my daughter shaved Princess Leia's head, too.
What?
So, there you go.
So for you, Star Wars was your big thing growing up then, hey?
Yes, and as a kid. Course, Luke, yeah. And it was, I had all the action figures and everything, yeah.
Luke or Han? Was it Luke for you?
It was Han Solo, actually.
Hmm.
You know, I mean, I like both of them, but it's funny, I have younger cousins, and they are, I guess, 13, 14 now, and they still love Star Wars, and they have the video games and all these things. It's amazing to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I shared with them, and I'll share with you and your listeners. I remember every week or two I would go to the store and I was going to get a new action figure, and that Princess Leia action figure would always look at me and I'd be like, can't do it. just couldn't get it. I would just get repeats of the Stormtroopers. I was like, no, I'm not getting a girl doll. I wasn't going to do it. So I never did get the Princess Leia doll.
It's so true, and it's probably worth so much money now just for that exact reason alone.
Right. I was just like, I can't have that. Yeah.
Same with like the pink Hot Wheels too. People would always go out, and no one ever wanted. Yeah, you want a pink Hot Wheel car?
Yeah. Oh, and I did voices on the Hot Wheels show in the early 2000s or late 90s. Yeah, early 2000s. I did Hot Wheels Heroes. I did that from Mattel.
Wow.
As well.
You've got
I did Robot Chicken. What else?
Now it's all coming. You got so much stuff in your old resume.
I do a lot of video games now, so people might know my voice from video games. Last couple of years, I did the Assassin's Creed Revelations. I'm in Uncharted 2 and 3. Right now, I'm doing, I'm just recording it the last week and this week, I'm doing the new Marvel Universe Online game.
Very cool.
It's kind of the World of Warcraft Online, and I'm playing a character named Dum Dum Dugan, Blizzard, in that. And then I also just am doing the Elder Scrolls Online, if people play that.
Yeah, I've played a couple of those games. Who are you in Assassin's Creed? Are you?
I am Altair's son, and I'm Dareem. In the Revelations game. And then I'm also other characters, and I wish I had the names. I don't know exactly. I'm sorry. But because I often get the script just before I go, you know, I walk in the room and I kind of, and I do it there on the fly. And I usually don't know what's happening in the game.
Wow.
So I hate to break the illusion for everybody. But, I just read the they're like, you're being chased here. It's a lot of being chased, or you're going to kill him, you're waiting.
Yeah. Usually, yeah. It's okay.
Yeah, you're waiting to be killed, you're going to kill him, you get mad at the player. My favorite are the lines where they prompt the player to pick up the remote, the game player, instead of, like, because, you know, you're just sitting idle.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so my favorite are those prompts, like, these are really nice walls. Or whatever, right? So that the player does, I got to play the game again. But you do like 10 of those, the prompts that do those.
Okay.
Yes. So I don't know if you can think, I don't know if you have my, my IMDb there. You can see what I've been up to.
So you've really, like, there's pretty much, you've covered every angle of every piece of pop culture and everything in the last...
There's still more for me to do, I hope.
What's in the future for you, then? What are you looking to do? Anything, bucket lists or any goals you got in the future? Anything you want to do? Or?
Well, you know, it's funny. Someone asked me about my bucket list. Like I said, my bucket list was to work with Luke Skywalker as a kid, and I ended up doing that on Johnny Quest.
Mm-hmm.
I ended up working with the Fonz,
mm-hmm.
you know. And my third as a child was to work with Steven Spielberg. Now, I haven't worked with him directly. I've been in the Transformers movies, which he produced. But I would like to work with him more as him directing me. And, you know, things happen all the time. I'm literally, as I'm talking to you on the phone right now, I got a phone call from my agent. I probably just got a job that I don't even know. I won't even know until after I hang up with you. So, yeah. No, I'm doing okay. I'm doing the soap opera. I would like to do more primetime stuff and movies, but... keeping busy is the most fortunate thing you can do as an actor. So I'm very fortunate.
Maybe Spielberg was calling you, and this is like, this could be the last you know interview you do before you just blow up and become huge.
Right, right.
And then I could take credit for that, being like, yeah, you know, I was there.
If it was Spielberg, I'll call you right back, D.
Okay,
I'll call you right back.
Okay. And then when you're done that, you come back to Canada, and we can reboot and be all, you know, move on with our lives, I guess.
It sounds great. Sounds great.
All right, Michael. Well, hey, you know what? Thanks so much for the time. You have got an incredible resume, man. You're like IMDb. I open it up now. It's like
it's really funny. My buddies call me IMD Benier because my knowledge is like the IMDb, but also because maybe I'm kind of like a Canadian Kevin Bacon. And before I forget, have all the fans of Reboot follow me on Twitter, because every time I do a convention now, I ask people to ask me the questions on Twitter before I do the panel.
Mm-hmm.
So... my name, it's just my name, Michael Benier, no spaces, MichaelBenyer, at the Twitter handle there.
All right. Thank you so much for the time, and appreciate chatting.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.